Not watering your Christmas tree is a horrible idea. Inviting someone to church is a wonderful idea. Don't burn down your Christmas tree. Invite someone to church.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Ben. Welcome to Four Corners Church. Hey, I'm holding in my hand a little hand-carved statue. This is from Africa. It won't mean anything to you, but this was a special gift given to me. And I want to tell you about it today because I want to talk to you about the power that a gift has to make a difference in somebody's life. This gift was given to me by a childhood friend that I grew up with. He lived, about two blocks away from me. His father worked with my father at the company. We went to school together. We were in sixth grade together, seventh grade, eighth grade, all the way through high school. We went to church together for a while. But my favorite thing about the guy that gave me this gift is he was the guy that I used to sit with for hours, and we would play Atari 2600. Some of you remember this? Yeah, exactly. The greatest gaming system of all times. But we would have a great time. We would play Atari 2600, Asteroids, Pac-Man, I mean, the whole bit. And I didn't know, and he didn't know, that later on in life, he and I would both go into ministry. I had no idea that was going to happen. And his name is Chris, and so Chris went his way, went to a different college than I went to. We both went into ministry, and then when we started this church, one of the things we decided we were going to do from day one is we were going to be a generous church. So what we started doing the very first Christmas is we started giving money away to people who were doing ministry, who were doing great things. We were early on helping the fatherless and the widow. That was a big deal to us based on the book of James, that pure religion, undefiled before God, is this, to care for the fatherless and the widow. That's just what Christians have always done for 2,000 years. Everywhere you find Christians, the plight of women and the plight of orphans increases. That's just one of the marks of Christianity. And so I ended up starting this church 15 years ago with a handful of friends and some wonderful people, and several of them are still in the audience. And Chris went with his wife, Jackie, to Africa, and they started serving underprivileged women, women who were coming out of prison, who had no skills, women who didn't have any education, but were being mistreated by their culture, and they started training these women and teaching these women how to do basic skills, how to be self-sufficient. They started teaching them about Jesus, because that's what the other thing Christians do. There is no Christianity if the name of Jesus isn't mentioned. A lot of Christians will serve and do good things. That's fine, but that's not pure Christianity. Pure Christianity celebrates Jesus and does great work. And so that's what Chris was doing in Africa. It was a pretty incredible thing. And so one day, while they were on break, they came by Four Corners. We were about a year and a half old, and it was not that far from Christmas time, and we decided as a church that the second or third thing we would do in the second or third Christmas that we've ever participated in is we would give Chris some money to help serve these women who were really, really put out in their environment. They were in a really, really rough situation. And so we gave them a couple thousand bucks as a church. It was a pretty amazing thing. And in return, I got this really, really, really wonderful statue, which I'm certain didn't cost $2,000. But nonetheless, it was a token, right? Because that's what a gift is. A gift isn't everything I care about you. A gift isn't all my value for you. A gift from me is a token of my love and appreciation and support. And that's what this was. And so the statue sits currently in my office right over there. And every time I walk into my office before I get in my chair, I look at it. Now, what you don't know about this statue is one of the reasons it's so precious to me is because a few years after Chris and Jackie had started this this women's center in the middle of a deeply fundamentalist Islamic environment where the plight of women is really, really horrific. And a few years after that, one day he was coming out of the center they had built that educates women and cares for their children. Let's make it clear what's happening here. He was yanked out of his car in the middle of the street by Al-Qaeda, and they shot him dead right there in the street. And I saw the pictures on CNN of one of my best friends growing up laying in the streets in a country in Africa that right now I won't name for you. And I thought about the fact that I'd never really known a martyr. I never knew a martyr by name. But I knew this guy really, really well. And instantly, this gift took on much more importance to me. I remember going in, and it's just a token. I remember thinking about the sacrifice that Chris and Jackie were making. I remember thinking about the investment that this church made in the work that was happening there. And I remember thinking about just how amazing this gospel is Now, the last part of this story, before we jump into the message all the way, is that Chris's family obviously moved. They came back home. They had four children. It was a really, really rough situation. And as you might imagine, their father taken out in the prime of his life, and what were they going to do? And this year, as I've heard regularly from Jackie, I got a note from her saying, hey, I wrote a book about my experience over there, and then she said to me the most surprising words, and we're going back, me and my new husband, this has been years ago, and my kids, we're going back, and we're reopening the center. And I thought about just how much faith and the power of the gospel at work in her, as she said, we love those people. We love them. The Lord has given us a special soft spot in our heart for them. And I'm looking at my email. I stand up from my desk. I turn and look, and right behind my desk is this statue. I don't know. My eyes filled up with tears a little bit, and I just thought about the power of the love of Jesus, the greatest gift this world has ever known, that still softens hearts, that brings love into dark places, that causes people to do ridiculously kind things, that make a difference practically here and now, but ultimately the biggest difference it makes is for eternity. This is the gift of Jesus. And one of the things that's on my heart this year, more than anything else, is that more people from North Cincinnati would unpack the incredible gift that is Jesus. That they would unpack it personally in their own lives. They would come to know him as their personal Savior, not just a gift given to the world, but a gift given to them personally to cover their sin, to bring them into God's family. And that they would know that when God does that for them, that they have been given incredible ability to make a difference in this world as God empowers them. That they would in their own way be like Chris and Jackie and the others that we have supported over the years. And they would serve their areas, they would talk about Jesus, and they would do the works that Christians are known for. Both sides of Christianity would be represented in their life. Pure and distinct celebration of who Jesus is and how he is the only way to the Father. And if you plan on living a life worth living after you're dead, Jesus is the only pathway to do that. And as a result of the gratitude that we have for him, just being kind and gracious and giving and serving to the people around you, because that's what Christians do. And then I thought, I can't think of a better place for people to come and experience Jesus than this place right here. My church family here, you guys, are the kind of people that I want all the people I kind of know but don't go to church. You're the kind of people I want them to get to know. There have been Christians in my background that I don't really want them to get to know. And these people are fine. They're imperfect. I'm imperfect. I'm not necessarily any better to them. But there are a handful of Christians I've known over the years that I don't want my non-churched, non-Christian friends to get to know. For whatever reason, just to be honest, the fruit of the Spirit aren't hovering over here too much. There's no kindness. There's no joy. Love seems difficult to come by. But then I know other Christians very much like this place. And I'm not pandering to you. I'm dead serious. There are other Christians very much like this place who I can't think of a better place to bring people who don't know that Jesus loves them, who aren't walking in the confidence that they're his child, who don't know what it is to be surrounded by a group of people, none of which are perfect, but they genuinely step into love and accept and open their lives to receive more people. Now, of course, that isn't all of us. Some of us, our brokenness and our path and our journey has created in us a certain hardness and attention and whatever else. That's fine. We got room for that. But the overwhelming arch of this place is towards kindness. And when I look at this statue, I think about that. How that you never know how much your gracious kindness, how much your love, how much an investment into another person is going to make a difference for eternity and exactly what it might represent. The gift of Jesus given to you gives you the ability to use your life as a gift. That's what this church has been all about from day one. So we're in the middle of this thing called a Christmas offering, and it's just a token. It's a token where we give a little bit of money, like we did for this family right here, like we've done. I've got four pictures I've been showing you the last couple weeks. If you haven't been around, let me show you them. Go and show them the first one. This is our church in India, where we have 40 girls and a dozen boys and a dozen or so pastors that we're supporting. On the right-hand side is the church building. On the left-hand four in the background is the girls' orphanage. And we have been for 10 years investing in this place. And so our gifts and kindness here reaches around the world to make a difference. And this Christmas, we're doing the same thing. We're helping these folks. The next picture shows you the space right here in our own building a couple years ago, where we have not built out our kids' space, which is currently, you know, built out. But it shows you what it was like as we were getting started. And over the years, through the Christmas offering, you decided that you wanted to invest deeply in the next generation, and you planted seeds, and you gave them a great space. And if you haven't seen it lately, a lot of work was done over the last 2 weeks. Like, you should go poke your head in the door and just see some of the upgrades that have been done just in the last 14 days. It's incredible because of your faithfulness. The next picture up here is our work in Cuba. In the foreground is Pastor Jose and Yami. They are the ones leading with Pastor Kevin, who goes to our church. The partnership there supports the work in Cuba, and the gospel is spreading like wildfire. A large church in Cuba is 30 people. That's a large church. Pastor Jose and Yami have a couple hundred people. It's a mega church. It's a mega church. And behind them in this picture are a bunch of young pastors at a pastor's conference, many of whom are supported by people in this church. And seeds of the gospel all over this dark land of Cuba is being spread. And God's doing some incredible stuff. This Christmas, we're going to help them as well. And then the next picture shows you a car lift, because this church is deciding, you're deciding, if you want to help people in our church family who are struggling financially, the fatherless, the widow, those on a fixed income, single parents, we're wanting to do basic car maintenance for them for free. So we're purchasing a lift. Should the offering come in, I've got some great news for you on that, by the way. And we're going to give some free car service and consultation to people from our own community. And after about 3 months, we get all the kinks ironed out of the system. We're going to let you find people that you know who need this kind of help. Send them to us, and we will do basic maintenance for them as well, because that's what this church has done. So you ready to see how we're doing this year? Our goal to pay for this and all the things we want to do was $80,000 and 100% participation of those who call this church home. This past week, we passed the halfway mark. We're at like $43,000 so far. Can we just give God a hand for that? Isn't that amazing? It's pretty spectacular. Now listen, some people gave a lot of money. Some people gave token money because it's all they had. The amount is not important. The important thing is that you have a part in this. So today in the offering, which happens later, or tomorrow, or online, give at least a dollar. Because when we start celebrating what God is doing through this gift, I want you to know that you have some blood, sweat, and tears in this. And it's just a token, but I want to tell you, God's going to do dramatic things with this. There is, today, we're going to discuss a spiritual fight that sometimes isn't obvious. And Jesus said it this way, that money is the number one competitor for your heart against the things of God. For some people, it's pure on greed. Straight up, greed is one of the seven deadly sins mentioned in theology. And it's one of those things that if it grips your heart, it shows up in your finances, in your emotion, and in your relationships. It's destructive. And one of the ways you break it is you give. For other people, it's not greed. For most of us, it's fear. And we believe that money is security and money is important, and it is, but it keeps us from being generous with our finances. But wherever fear shows up in money, I promise you, it also shows up in relationships, in words, and emotions as well. And you get to break the back of fear by giving. So am I asking you to give with absolute clarity? I'm trying to, yes, 100%. And of course, if you don't want to, listen to me, don't. You have my permission. There's a powerful word that as an adult you get to leverage. It's two simple letters. It's N and O. No. And most adults don't leverage it enough. So if you don't want to give, just say to yourself, no, I'm not doing that. It's fine. That's between you and God. This is still your church. But if you want to do these projects, the only way they happen is for you to use another simple word, Y-E-S. Yes, I want to. And so give something if you can, if you don't mind, and we will get these projects and others done. Final thing about this little statue. In January or early February, Jackie's going to be with us here in this place if we can secure a date. We're not quite done with that. And I want her to share with you the story of how our gift and other gifts that were given made a difference in their life and why they're going back. I want you to celebrate with me an investment we made over a decade ago. And what God's going to do with that. It's pretty, pretty, pretty special what's going on. And I'd love for you to meet this wonderful, godly lady and with a love that I just have a hard time understanding. And they're moving back with their still underage 18 children into what is still a very hostile area. And to the point that I'm not even sure we're going to be able to broadcast on that Sunday, the live stream of the service, because Everything they do is undercover. It's such a hostile place. And I'm so grateful that there are people who respond to the call of God to do stuff like that. And I'm grateful that there are churches like you that allow us to be generous to support it. All right? So now I'm going to turn to our message. We have been for 8 weeks together walking through the book of Ephesians. We're going to finish up today. So if you have your Bible, go to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. I want to walk you through a passage, but actually, you don't have to turn here. I actually want to read for you from the book of Revelation, the Christmas story that's found in the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 12. Just listen to these words. This is the Christmas story from heaven's perspective, all right? And then we're going to jump into Ephesians 6. I love this Christmas story. It doesn't sound like any of the others I've ever read. Here it goes. Now, a great sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun and with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then, being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain gave birth. Another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great and fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his head. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all the nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and his throne. Then the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. That's the Christmas story from the book of Revelation. It gives us a slice of the Christmas story that we often don't think about. We think about wise men, and we should. We think about Mary and Joseph, and we should. We think about King Herod's slaughter of all the young boys in hopes of getting rid of the heir to the throne apparent. And we should think about all those things. But what we don't often think is behind all these very seemingly earthly kinds of things and what happened in time and space, there's a challenge in heaven. There's a spiritual struggle that goes unseen. It's real. It's before us. And to our peril as disciples, we forget about it. When Paul wanted to finish up his words to the Ephesian church that he loved so much, that we've been parked there for 8 weeks working through it, when he wanted to finish up his words, he takes them to what for him is the most practical thing he can take them to. The problem is when you and I read it, it's not going to sound very practical at first. It's going to sound very much in the clouds. It's going to sound very much spiritualized language. When you're going through stuff and you want an answer from God, you typically don't turn to Ephesians chapter 6, because Ephesians chapter 6 gives you a lot of great stuff, but it doesn't give you quick and easy answers. What it does is it gives you a snapshot of the spiritual struggle that everybody in this room is united in. There is a battle for your soul. You have a real enemy, and the enemy is very, very, very good of convincing you of two things. You don't have an enemy, and what you're doing right now doesn't really matter. He's very good at this. And so he takes off your radar the spiritual struggle that disciples and everybody ever born has gone through. That's why I love the story we read in Rome in Revelation chapter 12. We're reminded that behind the manger, if you could have your spiritual eyes open, there was, metaphorically in image language, there was this dragon waiting to devour the child that was born. Now, if you know the story of Christmas, what was really going on in earth and time and space was Herod's trying to kill all the baby boys. Sounds like a king on his own, doing his own thing. And he was, except there's a spiritual dynamic going on as well. That isn't so obvious. Behind King Herod, fear and ambition and horrible actions was a struggle spiritually for what that gift represented, the gift of Jesus to the world. And Paul, when he wants to finish his love letter to the Ephesians church, he reminds us all of the spiritual struggle. I want to take you back to a time in our country's history. It was Tuesday, June 6, 1944, at 6:30 a.m. 5,000 ships were carrying 160,000 Allied troops, and they were approaching the southern beaches in France for the largest invasion in modern history at the time, what we now know as D-Day. The men who were survived and interviewed recalled that before they made a steady stream onto the beaches, broadcast on each of their ships were messages throughout the day, throughout the morning, reminding them of what was really at stake. Messages like, fight to get your troops ashore, fight to save your ships, and if you have any strength left, fight to save yourself. Messages like, we may die on the sands of France, but we'll never turn back. Or this one, this is it, pick it up, put it on, you've got a one-way ticket, and this is the end of the line. These messages were broadcast throughout the morning as they were preparing to launch D-Day, and over 2,500 Americans died that day, most of them within a span of 15 minutes, as they literally had to climb over the bodies of their dead patriot brothers and leaders in the army to get to the beaches. Now, the reason I'm talking to you about this is that an image like that reminds us of the bravery of these people. But I want to remind you of something else that was going on in the minds of those people. None of them had a delusion about what was about to happen. Nobody on those ships getting ready to storm that beach thought that they were going to southern France for a vacation. None of them brought along a beach towel and a ducky and sunscreen. None of them. They knew exactly where they were going. They knew who the enemy was. They knew what the objective was. And they stiffened their spines and their resolve, and they faced it head on and turned the tide of the war. When the Apostle Paul wants us to look as disciples of what we need to know as he closes out one of his most poignant letters in all the New Testament, he wants us to know that we are, in fact, waged in a war that is very, very, very similar. It would appear that the odds are stacked against us. It would appear that our enemy is fierce. But at the same time, Paul wants you and me to know that the battle for your soul, the battle for right and wrong, the battle that is spiritual in nature but shows up in very earthly ways, is very winnable because you have on your side your big brother Jesus. You have on your side the greatest gift that the world has ever known, the gift of Jesus. We celebrate his coming at Advent at Christmas time. And it was more than just to give us pictures of little babies in a manger and quiet cows and camels around a manger, which was probably anything other than a silent night, just to be honest, but it makes a great song. We're going to do it tomorrow night when we light candles. You have to. If not, it's not a Christmas Eve service. I get it. But just so we all know, it's probably kind of loud there. But what was somber and sobering about the moment is there was only a handful of people who really knew what was going on. So Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning with verse 10, these words. You can follow along on your message notes. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. And then he says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers and against authorities and against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So at this point, some of you are asking, is this the point at which this becomes a weird church, where we start talking about demons and the devil and all that sort of stuff? And I wanted to let you know we've been a weird church all along. In fact, the ushers are preparing right now to bring out the poisonous snakes. I'm kidding. They only come out at the end of the service. If you're a guest, you can get out before the benediction. You'll be fine. But I want you to know that Paul believed in an unseen world. Jesus did too. He spent a large portion of his ministry in direct conflict with demonic forces. And he summarized his entire ministry with this phrase, I have come to set at liberty the captives, people who are bound by something. And what they're bound by is a scheme meant for their destruction, to kill, steal, and destroy. Captives are captives because somebody made them captive to something. And so throughout Ephesians, our Christian life as disciples is referred to as a spiritual struggle. And so at the end of this book, we have to be reminded that when we have struggles that look like very practical problems, struggles in our own heart with sin, lust, greed, envy, fear, struggles in relationships with other people in a church, in your family, in your small group, struggles with people in the world, that while those struggles are real and might have some practical things you can do, behind it all, there is actually a force meant to push you towards destruction. And the problem is that if we don't see it occasionally, we would be like the soldier getting ready to storm the beaches at D-Day carrying a beach towel and sunscreen. Ready or not, they're going to face machine guns. So Paul ends telling us, here's what's really going on. Now the challenge here, I think, is spoken to very aptly by one of my favorite authors, a guy by the name of C.S. Lewis. If you haven't read his stuff, I encourage you to. He says, when it comes to the demonic, people usually fall into one of two errors. Either they take him altogether too seriously, or they do not take him seriously enough. So maybe you know some people who fit the first category. The devil is always out to get them. A dead car battery, it's the devil. Traffic jam, the devil. A sassy kid, the devil. A price increase of McDonald's sweet tea to $1.29 and not a dollar, the devil is out to ruin their ability to pay their tithe. You see how this works? This is some Christians. That is foolishness, right? The other problem, though, which I think is far more common, is that we don't see him at all. We never acknowledge and see that we have an enemy who's actually wanting to destroy every good gift that God has made available to you. Wants to keep you from embracing it, or if you've embraced it, wants to make it ineffective in your life. And if he can't make it ineffective in the life, he wants to make you so bitter and joyless that you don't enjoy your life with God here and now. This is a spiritual struggle. And I have to make something else perfectly clear, that your enemy doesn't care one bit about whether or not you believe in him. You have an enemy in your message notes right now at the bottom. You have an enemy that does not care for your recognition. He doesn't care if you see him or not. What he's after is your destruction. And it actually works better if you don't believe he exists. If you don't believe he exists, you don't ever have your appropriate guard up. You don't ever look for whether or not it's him behind your struggle. And so you ignore him. This is why Paul writes in 2 Corinthians that he comes to us as an angel of light. Your enemy does, in a disguise, so that you don't see him. And in our modern world, we don't believe in pitchforks and that sort of thing, and you know, a forked tongue and a pointy tail. That's not how he comes. He comes in the most sly, and he transforms himself even to good things so that we don't go after God things. This is how he works. So he doesn't make people's eyes roll back in their heads or foam at the mouth or vomit pea green soup or levitate 6 feet above their bed that often. It doesn't happen. What he does is he comes behind the scenes invisibly, motivating, undermining, discouraging. So Peter says, be alert. In fact, in 1 Peter 5:8, he says, be alert and of sober mind because your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. There's two primary images here I want to make note of. Satan's a hunter. And every hunter in the room, any hunters in the room? Any hunters? Come on, I know there's some conservatives in the room. Some of you have a gun and you shoot things. We're in the suburbs. I know I'm telling the truth. Come on. You know this is a hunter. You don't want to be seen. Your enemy doesn't want to be seen. So you can think that I'm ridiculous, stuck in some Middle Ages approach to the world, but this is the biblical approach to the world. A hunter doesn't want to be seen. So he's prowling around waiting to pounce on you when you least expect it. The other image in this passage from 1 Peter is that he is a lion, which means he's a member of the cat family, which of course means cats are demons. Next point. Just because you can't see him doesn't mean he isn't there. He's there. In 1864, there was a doctor by the name of Ignaz Semmelweis, and he stumbled up onto a theory that we now call germ theory. In those days, everybody thought that diseases were caused by something wrong in the body that you could observe. Like maybe having too much blood, so if you have too much, it'll bleed some out. Or getting too hot, so we'll make you cold. So doctors would go from patient to patient without ever washing their hands. And in fact, it was believed in those days that if you were a gentleman, your hands were probably not dirty anyway, because that was a sign of the lower class and the poor people. So they would go around touching people, a corpse one minute, a sick child the next minute, somebody who had a deadly disease the next minute, somebody giving birth the next minute, and of course, they spread all that we know now, germs all over the place. But in those days, nobody believed this. So Semmelweis got together and he decided that he would have his interns wash their hands in between dealing with their patients with a little bit of water and a little bit of chlorine. And statistically, his death rates as his patients were cared for dropped dramatically. And his infant mortality rate dropped dramatically. But he couldn't get the attention of the other doctors. And so he goes to a seminar one day where there's a bunch of doctors and he pleaded with them this thing. He said, "Would you please just wash your hands? There are these things that he called microbes, which were things that were too small to see in a microscope, so he just assumed they were there. There are these things called microbes," he said, "that if you would just wash your hands, you would not spread them." But he was laughed at and rejected. He died penniless and in an asylum. And it wasn't until 20, 25 years later that Louis Pasteur came up and resurrected this idea. And for whatever reason, it worked this time. And people started believing that there were these things called germs you could not see that would make a difference in your life if you didn't pay attention to them. And many Christians, I believe, are exactly like that in their Christian life today. You want to, and I want to, act like we don't have an enemy and that the stakes are not high. But every once in a while in this world, we're reminded that there is a genuine thing called evil. You can see it on the news when somebody abuses a kid, somebody takes advantage of the poor, when some ruler, you know, exercises an undue amount of authority and pressure on someone. And it breaks our hearts. And we look at our TVs and we read the news and we say, that's evil. But you can also see it from time to time as you look in the rearview mirror. I'm not talking about looking at your kids in the back seat. No. I'm talking about looking in the rearview mirror of your own life. And you can think about a handful of times in your previous life where things conspired in such a way. There was a person who entered your life at just the wrong time. There was a thing that happened at just the wrong time, and you were in a pressure cooker of decision, and you now, in retrospect, understand exactly how pregnant that moment was with potential for good or for bad. And looking in a rearview mirror, some of us can see the hand of our enemy at work, working for our destruction. It's very hard sometimes to see in real time, but you can see it if you pay attention. And some of you are parents and grandparents, and you can see it in the life of your children and your grandkids. You know that there's a real struggle that they sometimes are oblivious to. So Paul, as a loving pastor, comes to us and he says, "I want to remind you, my brothers and sisters, that there is an unseen world. There are spiritual forces. We struggle against authorities, not of this earth, but the ones that sit in heavenly places that do work in the dark. They're incredibly powerful." So with that in mind, then he says in verse number 13, "In light of all of this reality, therefore, put on the full armor of God. So when the day of evil comes, you might be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, stand." Then he says in verse 14, "Stand firm then with the," and then he starts to unpack these articles of the armament of a spiritual disciple. One who is blood bought by Christ, one who's in a relationship, a son or daughter of the King. We're called to put on these armaments, and I want to walk you through them very, very briefly because there's actually quite a bit of redundancy here, which is actually pretty beautiful because wherever in the Bible things are repeated, it's meant to give you a sense of its priority. That's why the resurrection of Jesus shows up in every single gospel in the book of Acts, and every epistle but two specifically refers to the resurrected Jesus. Everybody in the New Testament believed that Jesus was really dead, completely dead, not a false dead, but totally dead, and he's totally alive and reigning forevermore. That's Christianity. Without the resurrection, there's no Christianity. And we get a sense of that because of how frequently it's mentioned in the New Testament. So Paul, here in this letter to the Ephesians, is going to tell disciples, "I want you to understand something. I want you to put on certain armaments to help you, but I want to give you guys in the room today just a little bit of a framework to understand them before we unpack them each for just a couple minutes. Each of these armaments are nothing more and nothing less than the gospel of the Lord applied to your life in a specific way. Now, when we get together on Eve, I'm going to give what we call around here a basic gospel message. Now, I don't know what you think the word gospel means, so I want to give it to you in a nutshell. The gospel is not just a biblical message, although all gospel messages are biblical. The gospel is not just some advice about life, although the Bible has a lot of advice about life. The gospel, to be perfectly transparent and clear, the gospel has to do with the fact that you and I were dead and unable to save ourselves, and God sent the only way we could have life, that he sent his one and only Son, and that Jesus, in his life, death, and resurrection, did all the work that we could never do so that we could have life with God. So when we talk about a gospel message highlights the work of Jesus, its power to change lives, and its ability to call people from death to life with Christ. Without that, it's not the gospel. It may be good, it's probably worthwhile, but if it isn't about Jesus, Jesus' work, and how Jesus makes a difference, it's not the gospel. The challenge is, a little side note, a lot of churches are doing a lot of good stuff, and they don't do enough gospel. Because at the end of the day, if it isn't about Jesus, it's probably not Christian. You with me? You don't have to agree with me. But that's what Paul's trying to make clear. That these statements here are really about some way that the power of Jesus is to be applied to your life. They are not meant to give you a strategy for how to fight the devil on your own. Good luck with that. You're spiritually dead. I'm spiritually dead. Dead people don't fight very good fights. The power of Jesus makes us alive, that's the gospel, and it animates us and equips us in specific ways to fight our enemy. This is very different than me saying, here's three ways to beat the devil today. Have a good attitude. Think positively. Watch your words. Can we be clear, though? Too many of you have really bad attitudes. You don't think about what you're doing. That would be great. That's not the gospel, though. The gospel says, here's some powerful ways to fight your enemy. And in all of them, you're probably not good enough on your own. But the good news is, Jesus has done incredible work and will come alongside you to empower you to fight this fight. That's very different. So disciples, listen to me. You're not on your own. That's a good thing because on our own, we don't get very far. Each of these armaments are meant to be some power of Jesus applied to our life, some gift of God given to us so that we don't have to struggle against things that we cannot see on our own. What we have is an arsenal of weapons, each of them molded and manufactured by Jesus Christ himself. They are gifts to us. So, with that said, let's just begin to work through them. Verse 14, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled about your waist. In mind, probably Paul has a Roman soldier's armament in mind as he walks the people of Ephesians through a very well-known visual image that they saw daily. Some Roman soldier somewhere in a public place, fully decked out in his Roman gear. And all of them knew about the belt that they had. It's a very simple truth. You don't want to go into battle worried about your pants falling down. No, you don't want to trip over your underwear running into battle. That'd be embarrassing. So you put your belt on and you tighten it, and this creates the foundation of your armament. These particular belts probably had a certain amount of protective ability here in this middle region, which is a very good thing. But this belt has a name. It has an adjective attached to it. It is the belt of truth. Buckled about your waist. Now, this truth that he's talking about takes two forms. The most primary form is the truth that Jesus mentioned when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You buckle yourself up with Jesus. This is your primary armament. You acknowledge that he is in you and you are in him. And when you are with him, you're with the Father and you're safe. You take your identity from the fact that you are in Christ. This is Paul's most favorite phrase in all of Ephesians. You, my brothers and sisters, and I are in Christ. This is our primary statement of identity. The second form of truth this takes is all the things that Christ, who is the truth, spoke to tell us the truth. This is similar to Jesus' words, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. This is a rejection of all lies, the father of lies, and all deception. So wherever disciples have deception in their lives, sin is crouching at the door. Wherever you and I have hidden this and we're covering, sin is crouching to destroy you. That's why children of God are children of the light. We don't lie, we don't deceive. Because it goes against our basic nature as being ones who are connected to the very one who is the truth himself. And specifically, it probably refers to the truth contained in the Word of God. So you gird up your belt, you tighten your belt, you lift up your pants, and you get ready to go into battle with the truth of God, both as a person and as a content. This is why pastors everywhere encourage their parishioners to read the Bible, so that you have the best equipment with which to do battle. The belt of truth buckled about your waist. And then he says, with the breastplate of righteousness in place. Number two, the breastplate of righteousness. This is not you always doing right. This is the righteousness of Christ, his right being, his right doing, his right actions, his right nature applied to your life. It's just part of being a child of God is that God takes your brokenness and my wrongness and your wrongness, and he gives that to Jesus, and Jesus bears it on the cross, and then Jesus gives us his righteousness on loan to us so that his righteousness becomes our righteousness, and this gives us a place to stand. This is the covering for all the vital organs in the middle. This is the thing by which everything that comes at you is going to be deflected. It's a breastplate of righteousness, reminding you that in and of yourself, you and I are incapable of making ourselves children of God. We're incapable of walking in holiness. But because of what Jesus has done for us, we are powerful and strong. And we can stand against our enemy. And he doesn't have the ability to penetrate the work of Jesus because the Bible reminds us that Jesus' work is so powerful and effective that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. He's in charge. He's mighty. He's powerful. And when this reality of who you are in him begins to penetrate who you are and affect your thinking, then lies of this world don't impact you the same way. You can see through the fog, as it were. You can see the challenges that are coming sometimes long before they get to you. You wear this breastplate of who you are in him. So you put on the breastplate of righteousness. And then with your feet, have them fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. So these are shoes. These are shoes that you and I wear that are shoes of the gospel readiness, shoes of peace. And what this does is this is that forward advancing motion. You put on shoes to protect your feet so that the gospel can be spread. Two powerful things happen when you and I speak the truth of God into people's lives, the good news of Jesus. It enables and empowers us, and it encourages them. One of the reasons we want you to invite your friends for tomorrow night's service is so that they can be encouraged with the good news of Jesus. And so they can be around some people who don't have it all together, but they understand that I am being molded and shaped more into the image of Christ. This is my primary identity. I am not defined by whether I'm male nor female, Jew nor Greek, in the New Testament language, slave nor free, rich nor poor, suburban or urban, white or black. I am defined as one who's been called a child of the King. And when you share that kind of news with them, you make advancement. It's shoes you put on your feet. It allows you to walk and understand that you are equipped with the greatest message this world has ever heard, and that Jesus left you and I a commission to go into all the world and share the gospel. The good news about Jesus. Think about the 12 people who originally heard that message. I mean, could there have been a more ragtag group of people, largely uneducated, ill-equipped, without the normal social structure that came with influence? And Jesus looks at this harried group of 12 people and he says, now go into the entire world and share the good news. And most of them had never been out of Israel. Most of them had never been more than 15 miles from their house. And he looks at them and says, now I want you to go take this good news to everybody. But what happened was, is they began to understand who Jesus was, and they opened themselves up to all that God had for them. Each of them in their way was equipped, and they walked forward in gospel confidence. And in gospel confidence, there's only two things you need to know to share the gospel. I'm going to give those to you. You need to know that salvation is from God, not from you. Can I tell you something about me pastoring this church? The most freeing reality I had, and this is going to sound silly to you, the most freeing reality I had to be the man God called me to be to call this, to lead this church was, I woke up one morning a few years into leading this church and I realized, I can't save anybody. Now, ain't that silly? I should have started with that, right? But I thought if I worked hard enough and prayed more, did this, and was just night and always guarded my words, then what would happen is there'd be this groundswell. I still need to do all that stuff, but I can do all of it, and I can't save one of you. Heck, I can't save myself. But I am more and more confident that the only salvation all of us have is found in Jesus. And that then gives me a boldness, not in me, but in him to declare, and it allows me to walk forward. So I walk in who I am. I walk with boldness of what he's done. Two things you need to know is you need to know that salvation ultimately is only from God. You and I don't hold it. It's God's to hold. And number two, God has called you and me to talk about him. We're to testify, which means I don't make up facts. I simply tell the facts as I've experienced them, as I saw them. I don't know, friends, about anybody else, but I know this. He saved me and he changed my life. I know that when I was going through this season, he showed up and it made a difference in this way. I can't testify to all the details of the world, but I can testify to the goodness of God in my life. Salvation belongs to God, and I'm supposed to testify to what he's told me has happened to me, to others. And Christmas Eve, in part, is all about giving you an opportunity to invite people in to hear the greatest story this world has ever heard. After the shield of righteousness, then we move on to number four. After the shoes of the gospel, we move on to the shield of faith. So in verse 15, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. This is not a faith that you have that you can do all things. That's not the faith you're called to. You're not called to have faith in faith. We're called to have faith this way. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So all the things that Christ is strengthening you to do, you can do it. You may not be able to do all things. I can believe all day long that God's going to make me a master piano player. I'm going to be a virtuoso. The challenge with that is I've never practiced. I just believe really, 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 really a lot. It doesn't make me a master pianist at all. I don't have faith in that. But if Christ is calling me to share the good news with people and to live as a godly man to my wife, to my family, in front of this church, I can do that. Because I don't do it in my own strength. I do it through the power of him who gives me strength. This is what happens when we walk with him. The shield of faith is that thing that extinguishes the fiery darts. A Roman soldier would take their leather-clad shield, dip it in water. It would get very heavy. And when the fiery darts of the enemy, these arrows that were flaming, would be shot, they would protect themselves to stand against it. This is not an invitation to act like a ninja for Jesus. Here comes a dart. And it's kind of like Matrix, slow motion thing. No, 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 no. Listen, you're not supposed to be so skilled. You're supposed to hide behind the faith that comes from knowing you belong to him. No weapon formed against you can prosper. As Joshua said, you are blessed coming in and going out, which means there's never a moment that you don't have the favor of God upon your life. That you belong to the one who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, which means there's no resource that you need to do what God's called you to do that's unavailable to you. This is the hiding behind that we do. In Christ, every promise of God is yes and amen. And my faith is secure in him. And I hide behind that. I don't hide behind my intellect, my status, or the people around me who might support me. I hide with Christ alone. This is how I move forward as a disciple. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And then number 17, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The helmet of salvation, you put it on your head, it affects your thinking, covers your thinking. I've always been told that your identity is formed by the person that you value the most. You think of yourself as the person that you value the most thinks about you. So for so many of us, it's our fathers growing up. A lot of us, it's a spouse. For kids, it's a parent. Could be a friend. As a disciple of Jesus, what the Lord says about you is supposed to impact your identity more than anything else. So if he declares you clean, you're clean. If he declares a fresh start, it's a fresh start. If he declares you whole, you're whole. If he says you can do it, you can do it. This is the thing that you put on your thinking so that the lies and the scheming of our enemy doesn't penetrate. And the sword of the Spirit, the sword hearkens to images of the Word of God. One more time, to get into the Word so that we know about God and the way he works in the world. The final one of these armaments, and number 7, that often doesn't get included in the list, is prayer. Look at what Paul says in verse 18. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray for me also, that whenever I speak, words may be given to me, so that I will fearlessly make known the mysteries of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. So it's interesting. You get all suited up for armor, and then before you go fight, because it looks like you're ready, you pray as a child of God. Because prayer isn't preparation for the battle only. It actually is the battle. You put on who you are in Christ and all that Christ has done with you, and then you go to God. The Bible says we approach God's throne boldly. Now think about how silly that is. Who am I to ever go before God with boldness? I mean, he knows my junk. He knows how I failed yesterday and this morning. And I'm invited to go boldly, not because of who I am, but because of who I am in Christ. It changes everything. It allows me to stand before my Heavenly Father and say, Lord, I'm not perfect, but you are, and I want to go boldly after the thing that you've called me to do. God, I won't say it right, but I'll ask you to do what you promised you would do in your word, that if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask the Father, who gives to all people liberally without judgment. Thank the Lord for that. That when you ask God for wisdom, he doesn't say, you stupid idiot, here's some wisdom. He doesn't do that. He gives it to you freely without judging your need for wisdom. So ask him. This is how you put on the armor of God. I want to remind you as we close out our words today that we do not fight for victory that is yet to be attained. That's not what's going on in your life. You actually fight from victory that has already been won for you by Jesus Christ. If you're with him, you've already won. Now, practically walking that out can take some struggle. It's part of your development process that he's putting you through. Because he's not interested in just getting you to the promised land. He's interested in getting you and me ready for the promised land. So he's both working in you and working around you to do his good purpose. So the greatest thing we can offer people, the greatest thing I can offer you, is Jesus. The greatest gift this world has ever experienced. So let me just ask you something. When's the last time you, my brothers and sisters, reflected on the powerful gift that is Jesus? Every time I walk in my office, I see this, and it reminds me of what it represents. A modern-day martyr for the faith. And I get reflective, and I think about the times we played ball in the yard, and I think about when he would win some games, and I would win some games, and when we would go to church together and sitting in class together, all from this little gift. When's the last time you thought about the greatest gift this world has ever experienced and the greatest gift God ever gave you? And is the power of that gift, does it have freedom to wash into every area of your life? Does it? Have you put up roadblocks and said, don't let that gift touch this area of my life? Are you embittered by things that have happened to you such that the joy that comes from Christmas and the gift of Jesus can't penetrate your mouth, your words, your heart, and your thinking? Are you harboring unforgiveness somewhere? The gift that you were given and I was given is so profound. I invite you to do what the wise men did. Seek him out. Kneel before him and worship him. And have him wash your mind with the goodness that is Jesus. And lay off every sin that so easily entangles. And run with perseverance after Jesus. Put on the whole armor of God so that you and I can stand against any enemy that comes our way. Because in Christ, you are complete. In Christ you are whole. In Christ you are forgiven. And this is our message to the world. I don't have enough wisdom to share with the world, but I have Jesus. How about you? When they walk in this room Monday, we will have prayed. We will have gotten ready pragmatically in our building. And we will be asking God to show up in a powerful way. So we will sing both Christmas songs and we will sing worship songs. Because the thing that will capture people's attention more than anything else will be whether or not the sweet presence of the Holy Spirit is in this place. He's the one that draws men and women. We can't do it. We can be friendly. It's amazing. We can put up roadblocks. Our actions can be stumbling stones. But the Holy Spirit can attract. So I'm going to ask you people who love this place, pray for us. As Paul invited the Ephesians, pray for him. Pray that I may speak boldly and clearly and that the word of God carries the Spirit of God and it penetrates not just the ears, but hard hearts. And many, many, many souls are softened to the gospel and men and women become children of God tomorrow night. Pray that our church experiences a true moment of worship in the Savior that was the greatest gift this world has ever known. And we'll do our best. We'll be ready. We'll be prayed up, ready to go. But at the end of the day, we want God to show up and do his thing. Why don't you grab your Connect cards and let's take a few steps together as a congregation. Next step A is today I'm making Jesus my Savior and Lord. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus, I implore you today, do business with God. Do business with God. In a minute, we're going to pray. I'm going to give you a chance to bow your head and declare the most humble statement maybe that you'll ever say, God, I'm a sinner, I'm broken, and I can't fix myself. So would you fix me? Would you take the work Jesus did on the cross and in his resurrection, and would you save me? Save me from myself. Save me from sin. Save me from a dark world, and would you make me your child? If you want to do that, take the pen, check next step A. Put it in the offering bucket when it comes by in a minute, and when we bow our heads in a second, just pray with me, God, wash away my sins. Become the leader of my life. How about next step B? I want to be baptized on February 9th. This is where we celebrate the great work that God's done. If you want to be baptized, check the box, put it in the offering. We'll communicate with you. Next step C says, hey, I'll give to the Christmas offering. Don't underestimate the power of your gift to make a long-term difference. Next step D, I'll invite two people to the Christmas Eve service. You have two invite cards. Go to lunch today. Leave a good-sized tip. Put that card there. Invite your server. Go to the store. Invite the person there. Who knows what God might do with that? Next step E says, I'd like to talk about hosting a winter small group. Our small groups launch in January. This is where we gather together in circles, and we encourage disciples, to be the children of God that God has made them to be. There's prayer, there's some scripture, there's some talk about life, and relationships are developed. And we want you to be a part of that, and we need some people who are willing to host. Why don't you set that card aside, and if you call this church home, I'm going to give you a chance now to respond through your giving of tithe and offering. Now, every week I try to say thank you, because sincerely, when I think about this church and money, the first emotion I have is gratitude. And so just thank you that we can boldly say tomorrow we're going to be ready. A handful of things in the building are done and some special gifts for each guest on the seat to tell them about who we are and what's going on. You guys paid for all that. But tonight, I want to reflect just for 30 seconds about one particular aspect of this gift that you guys have received in Christ and then you reflect it back in your support of this place. My mind goes to a handful of kids. And they probably play whatever video game is hot now. I don't know. Xbox. Is Wii still a thing anymore? I don't know. My kids are past all that right now. I don't even know. But they get together with their friends and they're playing some video game. And they're, you know, they got their headsets on now and it's all cool and hip. And here's where my mind went today. I wonder how many of those boys and girls God's going to call into ministry. I wonder how many of them are going to end up in a mission field. I wonder how many of them are going to become godly men and women in their place of business, and they are a light in a dark environment. Amen. I wonder how many of them are going to become great moms and great dads. I wonder how many of them are going to earn money and give it to the kingdom of God. And I just paused and prayed last night for them. So God, I don't know who you're going to send us, but would you use us to give them a sense of how great you are? And that nothing in this world can compare with being your child. God, would you use our service on Monday to touch children's hearts and drive the anchor of the gospel so deep? Friends, I think a lot is riding on this. Eternity is on the line for people. And something silly like dollars and pennies helps create a place where eternity is changed. Do not underestimate the power of a gift given towards the work of the gospel. Your words, your kindness, your welcome, and your dollars. It makes a profound difference. And we're going to have a front row seat to see it tomorrow night. I'm so excited. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of a church that gives life regularly. Let's pray about our next steps in our offering right now. Father, thank you. Thank you for Jesus. God, I want to thank you that all the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ. That as your child, I am perfectly formed. I have everything that I need to accomplish all that you've called me to. I'm grateful, Lord, that you have the power to shut the devourer's mouth. I'm grateful that your truth quiets every lie. I'm grateful that your grace covers every sin. I'm grateful that you deposit purpose into each of your children so that our life on this earth is not wasted. I'm grateful that you take every bad thing and turn it for our good. Thank you for allowing us to be touched by the gospel. Now, Lord, would you take our gifts? Would you take our next steps? And would you cause them to bring glory to yourself? Would you cause them to bring good to your people? And Father, would you give us souls for your kingdom? We pray it in the mighty and the powerful name of Jesus. Amen and amen.